Allison is coming to the Thomas Crane Public Library this month, January the 24th. It's a Sunday afternoon at 3 p.m. Allison consists of harpsichordist Paul Cienniwa, who you've seen here at the library before, and Allison Messier, mezzo-soprano, but they're here right now to give us a little preview of the show on the 24th. Welcome to both of you.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming over. Appreciate it. And Paul, as I mentioned, you'd been here at the library before.
Two other times, yeah.
Performing. But now, what, a duet, if you will? Or?
Well, something completely different.
Okay.
Well, maybe. You know, my first time I played at the library, I gave a harpsichord recital.
Right.
The second time, I had a colleague, a recorder player, and we did a duo recital. But Allison is, this is Allison, but we are Allison,
right.
The band. And we are not a classical act. Although we have two classically trained musicians, and we specialize in more popular music. So,
with a harpsichord and a classically trained soloist.
Yes.
Okay.
I know this sounds crazy, but maybe we should give you an idea of the genesis of this project.
Yeah, please. How did this all get started?
Yeah, sure. Back in, I think probably March, I invited Paul to lunch to ask him if he would play a recital with me in June.
Okay.
I was booked to do a recital down in Little Compton, Rhode Island, where I live.
And had you known about Paul previously?
Yeah, Paul and I have known each other for years.
Oh, okay.
And it had been a while since we performed a recital together. And last time we did all Baroque repertoire, okay. Elizabethan lute songs and Baroque repertoire by Purcell and Dowland and Handel. So I really wanted to just ask him if we could recycle that program and refresh it, spruce it up a bit, mm-hmm. and bring it back out. But
I didn't look at it. But I think then you also said, can we do a few Joni Mitchell songs?
Yeah, I thought maybe as the encore, because on Paul's YouTube channel, he has a section called Harpsichordized. And I had been listening to his harpsichordized version of music by The Police and
Led Zeppelin.
Led Zeppelin.
So he's not alone.
It kind of sent me off thinking, well, maybe I could try. I had never previously done any popular music from this century. Up until that point, I had only sung classical music, and I considered myself to be, you know, a very serious singer who didn't touch anything modern.
Right.
So it was a little scary to me. So I said, you know, could we do maybe a couple of Joni Mitchell or Bob Dylan songs? And Paul absolutely lit up. And
I said, could we only do Joni Mitchell or Bob Dylan songs?
Please just do the whole program.
Because I think at that point I was saying, I'm really kind of tired of classical music right now. I need a break.
Okay. Yeah. All right, so it was kind of manna from the above that put you two together and said, oh, we're at the same place right now, let's give it a go.
It did.
Yeah.
And at first it was completely terrifying.
Sure.
I spent many weeks watching my musical life flash before me and wonder if it would be horrible. And the first time we got together to try it, mm-hmm. I think we realized we might be onto something
really?
Here and really fell together. Especially the Joni Mitchell songs and the Cat Stevens songs, they worked really well.
Now, did you rehearse these beforehand, before the public performance, or did you just
kind of...
Oh, yes.
Okay.
We rehearsed more than I think we would have if we were doing strictly a Baroque performance.
All right.
Because neither of us had
done
anything like this before.
Yeah.
And we weren't doing exact covers of the songs, although we were staying pretty true to what was written. We are kind of using our skill set and our own, obviously we can't unlearn what we've learned as far as our classical training. So even the covers that we do are sort of informed by the way we do other music.
Okay.
And
from that came Allison.
Yeah, after our first concert, which over 100 people came to our first concert.
Classical music, we'd be happy with 40. That would be a sellout, you know, 40.
Right.
So to have 100 people.
Okay.
And the audience was singing along with some of the songs, which doesn't happen in classical music.
Right.
Yeah. So
we said, we need to keep doing this.
Okay. So you found a new niche for yourselves, do you think?
I mean, maybe. And then what is the band name? And hey, Allison. That's easy. It could have been Paul, I guess, but, you know.
Yeah.
But I think Allison works better.
Okay, so you've performed, what, three times together now as Allison?
Yeah.
Okay.
And we've been having consistent rehearsals, which mm-hmm. has been wonderful. I think we're that served us well because we just recorded our first album.
Oh, congratulations.
Thank you.
Wow, so, that's exciting. So will you be performing some of that here at the Quincy show?
Yes,
we will be.
And we expect the album will be released by the Quincy concert. So, it should be out by then. So.
And is this going to be another kind of pop music type performance or a little bit of both? Spill the beans.
We mostly our songs are our modern songs. We have a lot of songs by Joni Mitchell and Cat Stevens. We also have an Adele song and a Bjork song.
Okay. Those aren't on the album, though.
They're not on the album, our concert here will include that.
Oh, absolutely. So folks have to come to the concert in Quincy.
They'll have to come to the concert, but you will hear us do, you know, what we technically specialize in, which is works of the Baroque, some Elizabethan lute songs, and some songs by Henry Purcell.
How long is the performance here in Quincy?
How long will it be? We can play for hours.
Okay.
We love it.
Yeah. Until you're tired of it or folks get up and leave.
The audience.
It's a free performance. and they usually have a very good attendance for these concerts on Sunday afternoons.
I should address the oddity of harpsichord in this music, because this is all, you know, most of what we do, although Allison mentioned Joni Mitchell and Bjork.
Right.
But most of what we're doing is neo-folk music of the 60s and early 70s.
Okay. Now, you're both too young to be influenced by those in your...
Oh, but we had parents who drove us around.
Ah.
That was the music in the car, I think, when we were toddlers. But, you know, we've also incorporated...
Adele.
No, we said that. But Rolling Stones. We have a Rolling Stones song we do.
Really?
I'm really drawing a blank. Phil Oakes, absolutely.
Yes.
So it's this sort of music. But you would think, you know, harpsichord, how does that fit with this? The voice, obviously. But when we started putting this together, it was remarkable how well the instrument worked with this music. I mean, if you think most of these singer-songwriters were performing with guitar, the harpsichord is very guitar-like. But in fact, I can do a little bit more because I have 10 fingers. So I can be even more involved and in recreating the accompaniment. And then, of course, we do sort of our own arrangements or sorts of the music. But it's just kind of a cool, quirky thing how this old music sound works with this newer old music.
Right.
It's all old, I guess.
Well,
except if we're doing Adele.
And a very old instrument in the harpsichord. And then the oldest instrument is the voice, right?
The voice. And I feel like the way that I've used my voice up until now has been in a very old-fashioned way.
Mm-hmm.
As I mentioned before, I had never really sung popular music,
right.
So I had an equally difficult time wrapping my head around how I would make my voice fit into or be applicable. I was very concerned about sounding too studied or too affected in this repertoire, so it was a big challenge for me. Also in singing English songs, as an opera singer, I'm used to being able to sing in French and German and Italian and hide somewhat in the obscurity of repertoire that people don't know very well.
Yes,
so to sing songs that people know and love and to sing in English.
But not just singing in English, it's singing in American.
Singing in American
or Canadian
English,
in some cases.
True. And to have to strip away the unnecessary maybe vocal affectations or that, you know, opera sound was really scary for me because I've never done that. And some singers have an easier time from their training or their experience singing popular song, but for me it was a big hurdle.
A whole new world, right?
It's a whole new world.
Rediscovering your talent all over again. So as part of the, I guess, mission or goal or hope of Allison, the band, to obviously first and foremost entertain your audiences, but maybe expose them to the Baroque through this
Absolutely.
Pop music avenue?
Yes, except that we've learned from our audiences is that people really want to hear these songs of the 70s and 60s.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
they want to sing.
They
want to
sing,
about
but it's
it, right?
very good songwriting.
Yeah.
And rather than I don't feel so much we're using that as a doorway for people to listen to classical music.
Okay.
It's more that we perform the classical works, that is Baroque, Elizabethan stuff, that is in the same spirit of the songwriters. It's all part of humanity, and it all works together, even though stylistically it's a little different.
Even if they know these songs, they're hearing them new again for the first time.
Right. And if they hear an Elizabethan song, it could sort of be out of the same sentiment as
right.
something that was written in the 60s right. or 70s.
So you've whet my appetite. You've tempted my interest. I can't wait for the performance. And I look forward to coming by again. It's January the 24th, 3 o'clock Sunday, in the Richardson Room, which is a gorgeous venue for any kind of performance. But our viewers here get a chance to get a little preview right now. I want to thank you both for coming over.
And our pleasure.
Hope you have a fantastic event here at the library.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
You are welcome. And if you'd like to get more information about this or any of the programs at the library, just visit their website, thomascranelibrary.org.
You'll find